Welcome, guys, to the official prototyping podcast, where we basically talk about everything to do with prototyping. And so in this season, you will learn about different aspects of the methodology, hear from different prototyping practitioners, and even see us try to make our own, all in the spirit of validating your idea with your own data. I'm Jonathan Sun.
And I'm Robert Scrope. This episode is sponsored by Exponentially. Supercharge your innovation process and get certified as a world-class prototyper with the official Learn Prototyping online course. Sign up using the code OG100 for $100 off. You can learn from Exponentially CEO and master prototyper Leslie Berry and develop your own prototype with personal feedback from Leslie. You'll also gain access to the Exponentially app, an enterprise-level tool to help you keep track of your prototypes, and join an exclusive Slack community of certified prototypers. Sign up today at www.exponentially.com/learn-prototyping and use the code OG100 for $100 off.
Our next guest is Alberto Zavoia. Alberto is the creator of the prototyping movement. He first wrote the book Prototype It in 2011, followed by The Write It in 2019. He also lectures in Stanford University and helps organizations all across the globe run experiments to prove if they are working on the right sets of ideas. Let's jump straight into it. What makes a successful product manager?
Product managers are very important. They're the ones that decide, make sure that you're building the right it, and then make sure that you build it right. On the other side, I've met some amazing product managers, and the ones that are most consistently successful are the ones that say it with numbers. So as I mentioned, in the early days at Google, the product managers, pretty much everybody there was very, very analytical, math-oriented, right? You have people with PhD in computer science that were product managers. So they use numbers a lot, and I realized that by using numbers, everyone can be much more successful because it takes away that subjectivity and it gets rid of opinions very, very quickly. Numbers are like acid for opinions.
Here's a unrelated question, but maybe it's a conversation starter. Do you think having 5 successful prototyping experiments is enough market proof to get a pre-seed investment from someone?
I think if the experiments are very well done, I think 5 is actually probably a couple more than you need. The key is the quality and the rigor that you use in the experiments, right? So you pick something. I think I've used this example before. Einstein's theory of general relativity, said that gravity actually has an effect, bends space. It really took one experiment, with the solar eclipse to be able to prove that in a very convincing way. So, depending on the experiment, 1, 2, or 3 great experiments should be enough. Now, why shouldn't you do just one experiment? Because it's very easy to introduce some accidental bias, or maybe on that particular day, everybody was interested in your product because there was an article in the news about whatever you're trying to sell. So it can skew the results if you are not careful. So I would say if you have 3 experiments and they all confirm convincingly that your XYZ hypothesis, then I think you're in very, very good shape to get funding and to use that data to get funding or to fund yourself.
I've heard David Bland say that he's a fan of thinking of a portfolio of experiments where there could be like the default 5, but if you have more of an experimental mindset, you can look at experiments as kind of like a series of them that basically explore more possibilities based on the evidence, whether it's weak or strong, of where you're going with things. So have you ever heard of the concept of the portfolio of experiments?
Well, I have the concept of running multiple experiments, and they can all be different. You can do a fake door online, or you can do other types of experiments.
Yeah, exactly. For me, I kind of want to take kind of like your journey slightly back. Because actually, as you remember, we interviewed Tim Vang and Leslie Berry, who are among the first 2 people that you taught prototyping to. What was your process behind outsourcing the prototyping methodology, and like how did you give the keys for like Tim and Leslie to get involved in evangelizing prototyping too?
Well, I didn't really give them the keys. They took the initiative and they did good work. So I told them, okay, you can be spokespersons for my work, because they have the combination of real passion, right? Skin in the game. They both flew to California, to Silicon Valley, to meet and study with me. Leslie did it twice. Actually, Tim Vang also came back twice. So they gave me skin in the game. They studied seriously. They evolved the product, and they're very, very good representative. I think, you know, when you see Tim Vang speaking, he has the same passion I do. When you see Leslie speaking, he has the same passion I do. So they combine passion, interest, they put in the hours, they put in the skin in the game. So they've earned it, right? People come to me and said, Alberto, can I be your, a spokesperson? I say, well, you first start speaking, and if you do good enough work, then I will come to you. So don't ask me, what is it? Don't call us, we'll call you, kind of thing.
I'm glad that that you took the time to, respect kind of like their hustle. Because I remember when Leslie like kind of talked about the story about, how he reached out to you, he definitely put in a lot of effort to, come in and reach out to you to teach him prototyping. I'm really happy that, that you got a chance to teach him. And then, off spawned out, things like the prototyping Slack group and everything and all of that stuff.
Well, I've done the same thing with this podcast, right? I said, well, if you get 10 guests and 10 podcasts, I mean, 9, I will be your 10th guest. So, put in the skin in the game, show me that you've done the work, and then I will come to you. If you come out of the blue and ask me to be on a podcast, I would say, like the first guest on a podcast, I would say, absolutely not. Show me what you can do before I chip in.
Absolutely. No, I agree. I think that's a very, very good mindset. With that being said, I'm curious because, as myself, I'm an entrepreneurial ecosystem builder, and I'm very passionate about using prototyping as like one piece inside of building a startup ecosystem. How do you think that prototyping can and should be used to improve entrepreneurial ecosystems across the globe?
Yeah, I don't work on ecosystems. I don't work on big, complicated frameworks. I am like basic algebra, right? Prototyping is like basic algebra. It's the thing that whatever framework you use, lean startup, sprints, whatever, this canvas, that canvas, at the foundation, there are some principles that you cannot deviate from. Otherwise, you're just dealing with fuzziness, right? So I find the XYZ hypothesis is the simplest synthesis that contains the whole idea, right? If you cannot articulate your idea in an XYZ hypothesis, then probably you don't have a clear enough notion of what your idea is. Also, there are ways of making things more complicated, but engineers and mathematicians, we like to make things as simple as possible, right? If I'm building a circuit, I don't need to put a transistor there where there is no need, right? Nor do I remove a capacitor just because I don't like it. So the elegance of having the simplest possible formulation that delivers the good. So I looked, at all of these different frameworks and books that come out, and I can see in each one of them what I teach applies. Let's take, for example, design thinking. When I taught prototyping at the design, at the D school at Stanford, one student came to me and said, Alberto, prototyping makes design thinking more thoughtful, right? It takes some of its aspects like the empathy, et cetera, and it balances it with some actual hard evidence. Makes sense? So what I teach is at the basic, it's the foundation. It's like it's physics 101, it's like algebra 101. And you can go on top of that and build more complicated frameworks as you expand, but you better get the basics right. I'm all about the basic. Get the basics right and the rest will work out well.
I love it. And it's something that like I try to tell a lot of like, founders, as I'm working with them, that I think that the very, very first thing that a founder should ever learn is like prototyping, right? And I think that that once they master the art of prototyping, then they can like go through a whole bunch of like their ideas and then really figure out which one has like actual consumer demand and potential, rather than like building stuff because they woke up out of bed and thought that, you know, that it would be the next Facebook or something.
Yeah, to me, the perfect example is the XYZ hypothesis versus the business plan, right? Yeah. So I actually did a video of how to redact the business plan, right? With the green marker, you eliminate all the stuff that you can approve. With a blue marker, all the hypothesis, you know, with the red marker, all the data that doesn't apply. And essentially, you're left with very little. So when students come to me, at Stanford 2 or 3 years ago, there was this event where they had maybe 10 experts, kind of people like me, and 20 groups of students. And each group of students had a chance to spend 5 minutes with each expert. So I thought, okay, what can I do in 5 minutes, right? And basically with every group, I told them, we sat down and we work on coming up with the XYZ hypothesis for their idea, right? So they came to me with this 20-page business plan, and we distilled it into 2 lines, usually an XYZ hypothesis. And every single student, every single group came out in 2 ways. One, they just had this epiphany, kind of tossed away the business plan because the XYZ hypothesis covered it. Another set of people, they learned that the co-founders had no agreement about the basics, right? So I asked them, you know, 20% of people are going to buy this gizmo for $40. And then when they wrote in, one of the founders said, wait, what do you mean $40? I think this should cost at least $200. And not until they sat down and wrote the XYZ hypothesis, they realized that they had this that disagreement. So that's the power of the, you know, working on the basics.
Well, we're talking about XYZ hypothesis, and some of the things I've seen people struggle with this technique is specificity. So are there, in your opinion, what are some techniques that, and this may be in the book, so we may be going over repeated ground, but what are some techniques that an experimenter can use to go from a market engagement hypothesis to a capital XYZ or even a lowercase XYZ hypothesis?
People always say, well, okay, I cannot come up and then say, okay, give me something. But every time they tell me what the idea is, you know, it takes me 30 seconds to come up with the XYZ hypothesis. Why? Because the elements are very simple, right? Why is your target market? So whatever idea is, you must have a rough notion of the target market. Even if you think, well, forget the product, you know, we want to put bike lanes, right, on Main Street. So who is your target market? You know, is it the bicyclists? You know, maybe it is. I don't know what it is. You know, is it the businesses, whatever? So it forces you to pick up the target market. Then Z is the behavior that you expect them to do, right? Which is use the bike lane instead of, you know, weaving in and out of traffic. And X percent is how many people you expect to do that behavior, because it's never 100%. So there is nothing more basic, just like, I use the analogy of, this is the simplest formula, F equals MA, right? Force equal mass acceleration. That pretty much tells you everything about the basic forces involved in the system, right? And what actually happens. The XYZ hypothesis is in that category. You cannot take anything out. You also do not need to add anything in, at least not at the beginning.
So can a market engagement hypothesis have multiple XYZ hypotheses attached to it, or do you see it as more of a one-on-one correlation?
Yeah, the market engagement hypothesis is like the fuzzy one, right? So, you know, most people, a lot of people will buy this marker, you know, this pen from Alberto because it's been touched by Alberto, whatever the hypothesis is, right? So it's a starting point. And then the XYZ hypothesis will force you to write it with numbers. Now, here's the thing. Unless you're doing this by yourself, or even if you're doing it by yourself, you're going to have a team of people. And as you go from the market engagement hypothesis to the XYZ hypothesis, some people may have different ideas. But ultimately, you must agree and converge on one XYZ hypothesis that you believe, okay, this is the one we're going to test and validate now. Now, since you know most hypotheses are not true, then you can go back from the market engagement hypothesis and you think, okay, can we switch our target market, say from cyclists, I don't know, to people on roller skates, to use that, that example, and then you come up with a different XYZ hypothesis. So, and then you find a way to test it. So you have this general notion, but then you need to make it concrete, and you make it concrete with your best guess, and then you go and test your best guess. And if that doesn't work, you move on and you tweak either the X percentage, right? Or the Y, your target market, or the action they expect them to take. So let's assume that I invent a portable power generator for when there are power outages, and it costs $2,000. So my initial hypothesis is 10% of people that live in places where there are power outages will buy Alberto's power generator for $2,000, okay? Then I do the market research and I find out that, you know, I can barely break 1%. So I said, okay, but my market engagement hypothesis is that people will want the power generator if there are power outages, and this first plan didn't work. What if instead of selling it outright, people can lease it, right? Because in California, we have fires in the summer, and in other places, they may have power outages in winter because of the snow. So I can come up with a different XYZ hypothesis. 10% of people that live in areas subject to power outages will rent Alberto's power generator for $100 a month, right? During power outages season. So that's how you go from this general fuzzy problem that you want to solve to different specific solution, and you can test each of them.
From your vantage point, has the pandemic affected what kinds of prototypes your students or your contemporaries do?
Yeah, well, there's clearly less infiltrator prototypes because people do not go in stores. So there is more activities going on online. But I must say that even before the pandemic, most of the companies that I work with, they use online as their main prototyping tool because you can reach a lot of people very, very quickly. If you go online, you can use a YouTube prototype, which means you don't actually have to build a convincing artifact. So it has changed it a little. It's less fun because I love to do live, you know, infiltrator prototypes. But yeah, it hasn't changed dramatically. I think online is still the best place to validate some of the ideas because so many techniques can be implemented online through the magic of videos.
But are the learnings of a qualitative experience where you're doing maybe low evidence interviews or basically just sticking with facts versus quantitative plays online, do you think there's a different purpose for each approach when it comes to kind of validating your XYZ hypothesis?
Yeah, so to me, so I'll give you my extreme stance, and I don't live by my extreme stance, but I think it's an important one. Just keep it in the back of your mind, use that as the foundation, and then it's inevitable that you will slip into the less extreme stance. So here's the extreme stance. You cannot read people's mind. People don't even know what they want or why they're doing what they're doing. You just look at what actions they take, right? So I'll give you the most compelling example, Tesla. So it's very funny. You know, I live in Mountain View, so like every other car is a Tesla around here, right? So if you go and ask people why are they buying a Tesla and everything, a lot of them, not the majority, not all of them, will say, well, you know, because it's green, it's electric, it doesn't pollute, et cetera, et cetera. And then I told them, you know, but you could have bought a Nissan Leaf that would achieve the same, right? And they said, well, but, you know, that's not as sexy. You know, the Tesla also is a cool looking car and it goes fast, et cetera, et cetera. So when you try to do these empathy interviews, try to find out why people do things, they don't necessarily tell you what the truth is, perhaps consciously or subconsciously. So my goal is always focus on the action. People look at what they do, and then you really don't care what the motivation is. Now, so I said, this is the extreme situation. Now, clearly, if you're in the store and you see people picking it up and then putting your idea back, and you can have some conversation with them, you can learn something. So you could say, well, yeah, the price is too high, really. I only had $20, but I would have paid $15. So you can get some feedback that way when you go in person. But typically, it's good to separate the right brain from the left brain activity, right? So when you do the, when you're coming up with the idea, like in design thinking, the empathy phases, you try to be creative, you engage your right brain, right? The creative part. So that's great. So come up with a lot of crazy ideas, be as creative as you want. But when the time comes to validate the ideas, I tell you, you're better off shutting off your creative brain, shutting off your emotions, and just look at the data. Now, it's impossible, but it's a good place to aim because you're going to slip back and you'll still make sure that you're high enough on that left brain quadrant.
I would think that post-purchase or post-transaction, it's good for marketing. It's good for understanding the rationale. It's nothing you can really bank on for the future, but it helps you understand the language and the rationale for why somebody engages in the first place. But I think it has to go after that intention, that something where they give you that skin in the game, and then you can go, okay, the interpretation of it is why, because it's going to be a completely different answer or very dissimilar if you ask that same kind of inquiry at the very beginning.
That is correct, Robert.
I do have a question actually about Amazon's Build It program that was introduced last February, where it literally looked like a play into prototyping, where people basically said, if we reach our pre-order goal in a particular amount of time for products that we're going to feature on Amazon that are not yet built, we will go ahead and start the process of going through the, start the process of making the product so that people can buy it. And then people who pre-order it have the advantage of getting it first. What are your thoughts on that program, Alberto?
Well, you know, it's fantastic. It's Amazon doing exactly what I say. You know my expression, go from if we build it, will you buy it? To from if you buy it, we will build it. It is the perfect implementation of that. And I know you talked to Patrick. I know there are a lot of ex-Googlers that are working at Amazon, a lot of people who read my book that are working at Amazon. But to be fair, Amazon has been doing experiments from day one. So, they may not call it prototyping at the time, but they were prototyping from the beginning, right? When Jeff Bezos was in his garage, he was selling books that he didn't have, right? He took the order and then he bought the books and then he shipped the books because he wanted to prove the main thesis without an inventory of books. So yeah, I love what that Amazon idea. I think it's they have their own in-house Kickstarter.
What do you say to people that have some, I would say, moral apprehension or hesitation in taking money before they build something? I encounter this with people that are thinking about doing prototyping or experimentation. They don't like the idea of taking money in advance of something that it doesn't even exist. They rather do what you had said before. They rather build than buy. But how do you see people kind of getting around that notion and saying, okay, well, I can put something out, offer it, and people can buy it first, and then I'll build it? How does someone get past that?
So first of all, let me state that all ethical dilemmas are trolley problems, right? So you just go one way or in other ways. Rule number one, do not take money from people unless you're 99% certain that you could build what you set out to build, what you're selling, right? So, the bad example here is, Theranos, right? The famous story, the blood testing. So, that was a lot of technology, a lot of magic and technology had to happen for the product to actually work. So to actually sell it to people without having it, making sure that you can build it, that would be unethical. I mean, especially when it comes to medical stuff, right? So I try not to touch that. Now, let's look at the other ethic, provided that you will issue a refund, no question asked, maybe even with double the interest rate, right? So suppose, hey, Robert, I'm building, this is a magic pen. You always wanted to write a book, I know, but my magic pen, you just put it on paper, you go out and it will write the book for you, but it costs $10,000. Give me $1,000 now, I will build it and then you'll be a first buyer. But if I do not deliver it, and the current interest rate is 3%, I will return you the $1,000 plus a 6% interest rate, right? So you're not losing. when people look at the ethics, I always tell them pretotyping is the most ethical thing that you could ever do, for the simple reason that the trolley problem, right? On one side, you have hundreds, thousands of entrepreneurs spending inordinate amount of time and money to build product that nobody wants, and they end up in landfills, right? Versus the little inconvenience of asking some people to participate, say, in a fake door or a facade. So what you're doing is saving a big problem. Do you agree, Jonathan and Robert, that entrepreneurs and innovators and inventors are one of our most valuable resources? Do you agree? Not if you do.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, how can you not agree, right? Who is the most? Because, you know, they will solve the world's problem. And do you agree that kind of having them work on the wrong product is a complete waste of time? So I tell you, because I can build a lot of useful stuff, but I spent 5 years building a product at a company, you know, one of my startups, that the market really didn't want that bad. So they wasted 5 years of my time and about 50 great engineers. So that's what I want to avoid. And ethically, there is nothing more important than you can do to validate that people will actually want the idea before you go ahead and build it. So there is no ethical dilemma. Pretotyping is the most ethical thing you can do. What is not ethical is to invest your valuable resource, the VC's money or whatever investors, to build products before you validate that the market will want it.
Are there particular industries where pretotyping shouldn't be done, or that it would be a lot more difficult to kind of execute?
No, it should be done in any and all industry, because, you know, failure can happen everywhere. So in some other industry, you have to be a little careful. And the canonical example here is in the medical industry. It's one thing to say, you know, if you give me $1,000, I will develop this magic pen. It's another thing to say, well, you know, you have that really nasty medical condition, and here's a cure, and then you go and that's a fake door. So absolutely do not do that. That clearly is unethical. Now, having said that, there is actually an article from in the New England Journal of Medicine, that kind of the number one journal in medicine, that refers to pretotyping and emphasizes how even in medicine, sometimes people go down the wrong road and develop procedures or systems that nobody follows, and that pretotyping done in an ethical way is absolutely the right thing to do. So there is no industry where you shouldn't do pretotyping, and in some of them, it's a little bit more challenging. You may not use some techniques like the fake door, but there's plenty of other techniques that you can use to your advantage.
Final question for me before I turn over to Jonathan. Have you ever seen pretotyping being used for parenting?
I can tell as a parent. I haven't thought about parenting in particular, but I know many examples of pretotyping used in real life. So I'll give you several ones. So parenting, so I will call in my daughter and how she pretotyped. So the first thing, she was living in Berkeley in a two-bedroom apartment. She wanted to live in San Francisco, but San Francisco's rent is much more expensive than Berkeley. So she would have to downsize to a one-bedroom apartment. So she pretotyped it. She locked one of the bedrooms for a period of a month to see, can she live, you know, in a much smaller apartment? And when she realized that it's no problem having one less bedroom, she moved. Then once in San Francisco, she had to do another pretotype, because parking in San Francisco is a mess. And plus, you know, there's a lot of car damage, you know, people, it's a crowded city. So she thought, can I live without a car? So she pretotyped, she dropped her car at our house, and she tried to go for 3 months without a car. And then she had the evidence, the data, right, that she can actually get around well without a car, and that she would actually save money because she wouldn't pay for insurance and gas and maintenance, et cetera, et cetera. And so she did that. Now, for parenting, whatever I would still start with the XYZ hypothesis. You know, my son will spend 30% more time doing the homework if I promise that he can watch, you know, play video games later in the day, and then do it on a small scale. By the way, good luck. Yeah, parenting is tougher than most jobs. You know, I paid my dues. My kids are grown up and they're doing fine. And I suspect your kids will do great too, Robert.
Well, thank you for that, Alberto. I think so as well. So far, it's an experiment in practice. But yes, I actually do pre-dotyping as part of parenting, but it's just in different ways. It's sometimes it's extracurricular activities. Other times it is related to screen time and work. But I do actually practice it a bit. I should actually publish a few of those formulas and see if other parents could use those as well. But well, we'll see what happens.
Because in a sense, you know, what I teach is the scientific method, you know, to kind of, and what you want to do is there a more scientific method of raising kids than just, you know, ballparking it, right? So good. That would be even a broader market than the one for my book and my work, right?
I think it would be a compliment to it, using it as a base and just saying, okay, here's a practical application of the method in this scenario and how it would be interpreted. So yeah, at least that's the idea. Jonathan, what are some of the questions? I know we're closing out our interview with Alberto here. So what are the questions that you have for him?
What can we do to further evangelize the pre-dotyping movement, and where do you want to see it taken?
I think that what I like best is what I see Robert do, which is start with the XYZ hypothesis, right? If there is one thing that you do, it really is the most basic thing. And it's interesting because it's something that I discovered. I didn't set out to do it. You know, I wrote in the book how I came around it. So I don't even take credit for it. It's kind of, you know, just came to me. It appeared, but it is the one tool. It just like, if you can articulate a clear XYZ hypothesis, everything really falls into place, because that tells you from that how you hypozoom, come up with the experiments. It gives you the data. So that's, to me, it's the core thing. The other one is say it with numbers. I recently gave a seminar at the Lean Product, Lean UX meetup, where I actually took all of these examples, all these things that people just wave their hands, and I showed them how to put them into numbers and actually how to count success and failure. So those are the two things that I believe people should focus on. So whenever you're dealing with an entrepreneur, including your ideas, say, before you tell me anything, here's what an XYZ hypothesis is. What is the XYZ hypothesis for your idea? And then, you know, as they progress, to try to express things in number. How do you define success? You know, success is you do better than the XYZ hypothesis indicates. And then from that, you go to the experiment. So that's how I think you should do it. Not by, how do I say this? Not by focusing on the personality, right? So a lot of people say, you know, Alberto, you know, I know you ask a lot of questions. What is Alberto like? You know, what does he like? Who cares, right? It doesn't matter. You know, I said, just focus on the actual numbers and the tactics. Eliminate all personalities. You know, Alberto, after this, you may think, well, Alberto is a tough ass and he's a jerk, right? I said, that's okay with me, because my job is to make sure that you stick to the fundamental in order to be successful. So don't focus on me, on my name, my background, what I like. Just focus on the basic, and the most basic thing is the XYZ hypothesis.
All right, got it. Rob, do you have any last thoughts before I give the closing message?
No, I think it's what's important also is that people are going to approach Alberto's work from different angles based on what industries and what professions they come in. So if someone is more of a designer, they kind of want to know, they want to be more human centric, or at least that's sometimes the angle. They'll come around to what the XYZ hypothesis is and means and how it's actually used. But some people need to kind of have some sort of like cognitive bridge to get there, in my experience. So people are kind of game to saying it with numbers and using data. But for every person, it's a little different. And I find that sometimes the conversation of how they get to that point is very interesting, because then I can interpret it and anticipate where people will ask those questions that Alberta gets a lot of. You know, like, how do I go from a meth to an XYZ? What were the components of an XYZ? How do I do my percentages? Thankfully, though, Alberto has been listening. He's been putting a lot of his Q&A and also his perspectives on his YouTube channel. So that's updated in fairly infrequently. But and when I say infrequently, I mean like every 1, 2 months, 3 months, depending on when he has time. But I would say that particular medium is a great companion to The Right It, which is the book that Alberto had that he came out in 2019. And that answers a lot of the questions that I hear people talk about when they are doing prototyping for the first time and when they're starting their experimentation, especially if they're so focused on their business entrepreneurship and just speak that language but don't understand experimentation. Would that be fair to say, Alberto, that the YouTube channel is a pretty good resource for furthering your understanding?
Yes. Thank you. Yes. And you know, the posting are infrequent because I don't like to waste my time or people's time. If I have something new that I haven't expressed before, I will do a video. Otherwise, so when something new comes for me, you know that it's meaningful. Now about designers, I work with a lot of designers and, they're more right brain people, kind of more creative. And I tell them you really need to differentiate two things, right? So there is this a well-designed pen, right? So the designer may say, no, it's a little thicker because, so you can hold it better. There's less hand fatigue, et cetera, et cetera. I said, look, I am not in the making designs better business. So it's very important to know what business you're in. I'm in the business of making sure that whatever you design, there is an initial market for it. Because if there isn't, if it's not desired, people don't care how great the design is for a product that you don't want. So designers, I would say, they are not my clients, right? They're not the people that use my system. They're kind of the creative people. The people that need and use my systems are the ones that actually are responsible for making sure that people buy the product that it's designed. I love designers, right? I'm sitting on a very nice designer chair, and I'm very glad that whoever designed it did such a good job because I'm so comfortable in it. But that's not my area of expertise. So yeah, if designers don't use my work, I fully understand because I didn't do my work for them.
All right, listeners. Thank you so much for listening to our podcast. This is our episode with Alberto Savoia, the creator of prototyping. And remember, guys, fail Ferrari fast, McDonald's cheap.